sponsors here at CIIS who generously helped fund this event tonight. And that's the Bachelor's Completion Program, the Master of Fine Arts Program, Ecology, Spirituality, Religion, and the East-West Psychology Program have all been part of bringing Starhawk here tonight. Now, I know that Starhawk probably needs no introduction in this room, but I will share a few words about her for those who may not know. Starhawk is a committed global justice activist and organizer and one of the most respected voices in the goddess and earth-based spirituality movements. She is the author or co-author of 12 books, including The Spiral Dance, The Fifth Sacred Thing, and The Earth Path. Her latest is The Empowerment Manual, A Guide for Collaborative Groups. A veteran of progressive movements from anti-war to anti-nukes to Occupy, Starhawk has brought many innovative techniques of spirituality and magic to her political work. She has trained activists in direct action and organizing, taught earth-based ritual, healing, and community building worldwide, and directs earth activist training. And flyers about, postcards about earth activist training are going around, which combines permaculture design with a grounding in spirit and a focus on organizing skills. She travels internationally teaching magic, the tools of ritual, and the skills of activism. Her website is www.starhawk.org. But as I said earlier, she probably needs very little introduction in this room. I imagine that most of you, like myself, have been deeply influenced by her work. I remember coming across The Fifth Sacred Thing probably about 15 years ago or so as an undergrad. And I cited her work in my dissertation on spiritual activism. I know many of you have studied her work, may have taken trainings with her. I just heard from someone who, someone in this room has been in jail with her. and one of the things that's so incredibly amazing about Starhawk's work is that she brings these age-old wisdom from earth-based spirituality and goddess traditions and makes it real and relevant and applicable to real global social issues that are happening in our day, and therefore she's an inspiration to us all. So please join me in welcoming Starhawk.
You can maybe cover it. I'll tell you like the perfect dramatic moment to reveal it.
Okay, great.
So, hello everybody, good evening. CIIS. I was asked to come here. I was told that some of the students felt confused about the issue of Palestine. So I'm curious if anyone here feels confused. I think there's aspects of it that confuse us all, and I won't guarantee to strain it all out for you, but I am hoping to share some of my experiences and my knowledge about the background and the situation, and to leave time for us to have time for questions and discussions so that we can hopefully clarify anything there. The BBC some years ago did a poll of its viewers to find out what people knew and understood about the issue. And they realize that even in England, where the coverage is so much better than in the U.S., something like 70% of the people watching thought that the Palestinians had invaded the Israelis. It was an amazing level of ignorance and confusion about the issue out there. So I wanted to actually begin by telling you a little bit about my personal history and background. I was born into a Midwestern Jewish family in 1951, which was just 5-6 years after the end of World War II. My family, my grandparents were Orthodox. My parents were the generation that rebelled in different ways. My father was a communist and very political, but he died when I was very young. My mother was a psychologist and much more psychological. But if there was one thing that everyone agreed on, it was Israel. I think my mother told me later my father wouldn't have agreed, but he wasn't really around to speak for his point of view. But everybody else Orthodox, Reform, secular, liberal. You know, it's as if we grew up with this story. That's a very powerful story, and the story kind of goes like this. There was a people who had come to a land that was their sacred land after wandering in the desert, guided by their gods, and they lived there for thousands of years and built a very strong culture. But in a time of rising empire, they were exiled. And for 2,000 years, they wandered the world, sort of the butt of everybody's oppression, the scapegoat for every problem, until finally, in just many of our own lifetimes, they suffered one of the worst genocides anyone could imagine. 6 million people were wiped out in Europe. At a certain point in that wandering and that oppression, some of them began to get the idea that they should go back. Should go back to their own land. Their land was the heart of their ritual for thousands of years. It's their sacred calendar still followed the rhythms of the climate and the land that they came from. They still sang the songs and followed the seasonal traditions that they had grown up with. And finally, 150 years ago, some of them said, we should go back. We should go back and we should reclaim that land. We should take it back from desert and wilderness and we should make it ours again. And with great struggle and courage, they did that. And at the end of this horrible genocide, this land became the refuge. And in some sense, it became the one good thing that came out of all the horrors of the Holocaust. That was the story I was raised with. It's a powerful story. You know, it's a deeply emotional story. There's only one problem with it. That is that there happened to be actual people on that land. And you could tell another story. You could say that there was a land that had been from time immemorial the crossroads of the world. From long before human beings even existed, it was the place where migrations of animals came from Africa and went to Asia and Europe and back again. It was the place where when human beings first started to stagger out with their caves. They came from Africa and spread to the rest of the world. And it remained an important crossroads to this very day. And in that crossroads, there have always been people living. People who sometimes were conquered by other people because it was a place where armies that wanted to conquer the world had to go through on their way there and their way back again. It was a place where cultures merged, where different heritages of people came together. But there were always people there, and people who had lived in that land and never left. Some of them were the same heritage of those people who had gone into exile. Probably if you could delve through all the genes, you'd find that there's not much difference between those people. And when those other people decided, hey, it's time for us to come back and claim our land, there was this inconvenient fact that it wasn't actually empty. It was actually full of people. People who loved that land, who were deeply attached, who had lived on that land for generations upon generations upon generations, and like weren't that anxious to just move aside and give it over to somebody else, or to give over the governance of that land to a religion that wasn't theirs. So I think when we look at the history of Palestine, I find it easier to understand if we understand that narrative, if we understand the emotional power of it, and if we understand that the problem with the Palestinian people from the point of view of that narrative is really that they exist. Because by existing, they spoil the story. It's not really such a great story when you start to say, oh, and we decided to go back to our sacred land and take it away from people who'd been living there for 2,000 years. It's hard to admit that. It's hard to maintain the view of yourself as the innocent victim and the good people and acknowledge that at some point the decision was made to take it away. And so I know for myself, growing up, going to Sunday school and Hebrew school and in the Jewish community, when I look back on it, I'm actually kind of astounded at how little mention there ever was of the Palestinian people. You know, people talk a lot about cultural appropriation these days, and we can have another interesting discussion about that, because I think it's a concept that's often like way misused and warped. But when I think back on all of these things that were taught to me as Israeli culture, falafel, folk dance, hummus, all those things are actually Palestinian or Arabic culture. And somehow or other, the Palestinian people got completely erased. If you look back at the history of the early days of Zionism back in the 1800s, there were two rabbis who were sent to Israel to scout it out, to say, what are the potential for actually, you know, establishing a base there, for bringing colonies back there? And they went there and they sent back a message that said, the bride is beautiful, but she's already married. Unfortunately, they didn't hold to that vision, and they kind of, the idea was that, oh, well, the bride is beautiful, and if she's already married, then let's get rid of that husband, because she's supposed to be our bride. So that's kind of the background. Say for my personal history, you know, I grew up with this. The first time I went to Israel, I was 15. I went on the Hebrew High School Summer Olpan in Israel program, where we all went. We spent the summer on a kibbutz. We got taken to historic places in Israel, mostly places where people died. But we began, you know, like the more cynical among us started to keep a body count of our... how many people, how many martyrs were here and how many martyrs were there. But we went to beautiful places, we got taken to inspiring places that people had built. And I remember one key point, we were up in the Galil, in the north of Israel, taken up very close to the border with Jordan. And you could see on the Israeli side, everything was green and beautiful, you know, trees planted and there were forests. And on the other side, it was bare and it was desert. And what we were told was, look, you know, look what we've done with this land. We've made the desert bloom, and look at them, the Arabs, they haven't done anything with it. Again, there's a piece of that narrative that got left out that we will talk about tonight. One key fact, which was that, yes, they made the desert bloom, but that was because they took all the water and didn't leave much for the people on the other side to have any option for making their side of the desert bloom. So that was what I grew up with. And as I got older, I became a political activist. I became a radical in many, many ways. I became what currently people call a PEP. It's a progressive on everything but Palestine. because really it was too painful to look at the issue of Palestine. To look at that issue meant I had to not only look at what I was taught by my parents and by teachers and mentors and people I respected and see it as false and see it as a lie, but it meant that I really had to grapple with that pain of the Holocaust, with the idea that maybe out of the Holocaust, this one good thing that happened actually wasn't such a good thing after all. And that the lesson of the Holocaust, which we were always taught, which was never again should this happen, is to recognize that some of us heard that as never again should this happen to any people on the earth. And some heard it as never again should this happen to us. And when you take the view that never again should this happen to us, that becomes a very dangerous view to hold because it opens the door to your becoming the oppressors who are willing to do that same kind of oppression to somebody else. But, you know, over the years, reality started to get through all of this denial and pain. It still wasn't really the issue I wanted to take action. I really felt like I'm doing so much for the world. I'm a feminist. I'm a global justice activist. I'm blockading the WTO, you know. This will help the people in Palestine ultimately, you know. I don't really have to get involved in this. And then one day, I saw a story online about a woman named Netta Gola, who is an Israeli activist who had begun living in Palestinian villages in order to be a witness, in order to be a nonviolent intervention between settlers and the villagers, because the Israeli settlers would go to the edge of the village and they'd taunt the kids and they'd sort of provoke them into throwing stones, and as soon as they threw stones, the army would come in and start shooting and would often would kill people and would really do tremendous violence. So she began living there because she, as an Israeli, could use her privilege as an Israeli to step out in front and intervene with the settlers and often turn them back or interfere with what they were doing. She would chain herself to olive trees that were about to be bulldozed and cut down in order to protect them. And I read that and I thought, wow, she's really amazing. And here's her email address. This was in, you know, the days when it was still like wildly exciting that you could like get an email address for someone across the world and send them an email. Maybe some of you don't remember that. So I sent her an email. That was my mistake. Yeah. Saying how much I admired what she was doing, and she sent me back an email. She said, "Oh, Starhawk, I grew up in Canada. I love your work, and why don't you come?" And I was like, "No, I can't do that. No. I can't. You know, I would prefer to admire your work from afar." You know? And we had some back and forth about that, and she was trying to encouraged me to come. And then by this time it was 2002, it was the beginning of the second intifada. The first intifada in the 80s was a very powerful uprising of the Palestinian people against the Israeli occupation. And the occupation had been going on since 67, since the war in which Israel basically conquered the West Bank, the Golan Heights, and the Sinai Peninsula. They eventually gave Sinai back to Egypt, but they held on to the West Bank, and they kept it under military occupation really until this day, which is illegal under international law. Under international law, you're not supposed to go around conquering other countries. And if you do, you're supposed to negotiate and withdraw your forces at the end of hostilities and not keep them there for 60, however many years it is now. But Israel didn't do that. It maintained control of the West Bank and Gaza. And so the first intifada was people saying, finally, we're sick of this. How can we get rid of this? You know, and it was a tremendously creative and primarily a nonviolent uprising that involved a lot of what people call civil resistance, non-cooperation, refusing to pay taxes, refusing to stand in line, you know, like good people at the checkpoints, demonstrations, protests, and it was very, very effective. It was so effective, it ultimately pushed Israel to the negotiating table, and that gave us what we call the Oslo Accords in 93. The Oslo Accords was supposed to be the deal that would allow Palestine to have its own state. And this was not something all the Palestinian people agreed upon. Many, many Palestinian people were saying, you know, basically said, no, what we don't want to settle for a state that's 20% of what we have. We want one secular state where everyone can live that will actually be a democracy. But Yasser Arafat and his party negotiated the settlement, and people kind of came along to say, all right, well, it isn't what we wanted, but maybe it's something we can settle for. At least we'll have our own state, we'll be out of military occupation. You know, we'll have a chance to establish a culture and a country and an independence of our own. That was in 93. And it is now 2014, which is what, 21 years later. The Palestinians are still waiting for their state. So, Nana was working with a group called the International Solidarity Movement that she'd helped to found, that was a movement to support the nonviolent resistance in Palestine. And the second intifada started in 2002. It was focused more than the first one on armed resistance. But there was a very strong wing of resistance that still said, wait a minute, nonviolence is our chosen path. Civil resistance is tremendously effective, and we want to build a movement that will support that. And there were many different reasons for that. Some people believed in it as, you know, a spiritual or a moral calling. Some people believed in it because they believed it was more politically effective than violence. Some people believed in it as an adjunct to armed resistance. Probably most people within it believed that Palestinians had as much right to defend themselves as anyone else, even with arms, if we live in a world where people defend themselves with arms, but felt that a movement of civil resistance offered much more opportunity for many, many, many more people to take action and get involved, because the price of entry to armed resistance is pretty high, and it's not something everyone is going to be able to do, but a movement based on civil resistance has room for everyone. It has opportunities for everyone. The problem was, when Palestinians would go out to demonstrate or would go out to protest, the Israelis would respond with live ammunition, or would round people up and haul them off en masse to jail, or would respond with tremendous intense violence and repression. So the idea with the ISM was, well, if we bring internationals, we can, again, put their privilege to good use to help open up a space for Palestinians to do civil resistance without getting killed. And those internationals will have experiences, will see the situation for themselves, and will be able to go home and talk to people about it and share it with people. And so they had built a movement that did some really amazing and heroic actions. But with the rise of the Second Intifada in 2002, the Israelis responded often by putting the whole country into lockdown. Massive curfew in places like Jenin or Bethlehem that would go on for weeks or months, where people really weren't allowed out on the street during the day or only for very, very, very short periods of time. It made it impossible to do anything like run a business. It made it difficult to go to school. It made it hard for people to get food to eat or to go to market or to grow food or tend their gardens. And there is a seat in front there.
Okay, we have one in front of you.
There's one right here.
And at one point, they went in to the town of Jenin, into the refugee camp. You know, the refugee camps in places like Jenin and Nablus were still there, again, since 67, where people had now built really whole towns alongside the town of people who were refugees from other parts of Palestine and Israel. There were still refugees from 48 in some of those refugee camps. And the military had gone in and basically bulldozed the whole camp. There was one guy who ran amok with a gigantic bulldozer and bulldozed something like 400 homes. And without, sometimes without even giving enough warning for the people to get out. So I got an email from a friend of mine who had been over there, who was also Jewish, actually, but had ended up hearing a call to come to Jenin right after this had happened, had gone there, and what she described was so heart-wrenching. You know, being there with families, with fathers trying to dig out the rubble to find their children, finding pieces of body parts, finding braids from little girls in the rubble. And I read that, and it just had this powerful effect on me, and I said, okay, I have to go. And so I went in 2002, three times over that year. And I had time that I could go to volunteer with the ISM. I went back in 2003 because a lot of us feared that when the U.S. went into Iraq, the Israelis would use that as an opportunity to make some huge move against the Palestinians, and we wanted to have people on the ground. I went back in 2004 when the campaigns against the wall were really getting going, and then after that I couldn't get back anymore for a while. So I'm going to show you and tell you some more of the story, but now I think it's the dramatic moment where we can reveal the picture.
Would you take that
And maybe turn off some of the lights in the front, perhaps.
Yeah.
And just say something to you about ecofeminism, since this is supposed to be an ecofeminist view of Palestine. Mm-hmm. And just say, you know, ecofeminism was something some of us thought up back in the 80s, when we noticed that the way people look at women is often the way we look at the earth. Talk about the rape of the earth. We talk about the same kind of oppression that goes on, and the same kind of disregard for the environment is also a disregard for those people who bring life into the world. And we started to look at the way what I think today people tend to call intersectionality, the way that all these different isms and oppressions are connected, and to recognize that you can't really separate them all out. You know, that sexism and racism and classism and homophobia and ableism and all the isms are things that reinforce and support each other. And all of them support a worldview that allows us to say, some of us are the people who count and some of us are not. Mm-hmm. And those of us who are, you know, the real people, like we get to treat the rest of the world like filler. We get to disappear them and make them invisible because they aren't really somehow as worthy or as real as we are. And to me, that ties deeply again back into that narrative around Israel and Palestine. You understand the actions of the Israelis as rooted in the idea that somehow or other Palestinians are supposed to somehow just not be there, somehow disappear. That they don't count in the same way that Israelis count. Then you understand the policies and you understand the justifications that people can bring for some of the really horrific things that are being done to the Palestinians. And I think probably most Israelis like would actually just prefer it if somehow or other, you know, there's a little blip in reality. Someone just changed the channel and Palestinians just weren't there. They'd never been there. You know, you wouldn't have to go to the trouble of oppressing them. But since Palestinians are there, then it leads to a whole lot of other necessities and consequences. And you also understand that for Palestinians, the core strategy of resistance that I heard over and over again is just survive. Be alive. Stay here. Stay put. Don't go away. Exist. Have kids. Hold the land. Be here. And interrupt the story. And I will say that Palestine has a long history of, one of my Palestinian students last year said, you know, we have this history of hundreds and hundreds of years of conquest, but in the end, we absorb all the conquerors. And in the end, we'll absorb the Israelis too. So here's the map, the basic map of Israel. Sort of the yellow is more the Israel of my youth. The extension into the Golan Heights is part of what was won in 67. The West Bank is when the area is under occupation, and then there's the little Gaza Strip down there, which is under a different kind of occupation. And this is sort of the history of the Palestinian loss of land. So when we talk about the potential for a two-state solution or one-state solution, you have to look at it in this context. Here's 1946. The white is Jewish land, settlements, kibbutzim, land that Jews had bought, acquired throughout that preceding 100 years of slowly trying to come back. This was the partition what the UN agreed to in 1947. The green was supposed to be Palestinian, the white was supposed to be Jewish Israel. And what happened when the UN agreed on partition was instead they ended up with a war. And in that war, hundreds of thousands of Palestinians were driven out of their homes, out of their areas, and became permanent refugees. Some in Gaza, some in the West Bank, some in Lebanon and Syria and Jordan and other places. And Jordan actually took over the West Bank. So this was 49 to 67. That was a map I grew up with. And this is what's happened in 2000. When they talked about the Oslo Accords and the idea of the two-state solution, it was supposed to be basically, okay, the Palestinians get the green, the Israelis get the white. That wasn't a great deal for the Palestinians. It was still 22% of what they originally had, especially because originally they had it all before all those little white spots. But there it was. What's happened since the Oslo Accords, since 93, is that Israel continued to build settlements in the green and to place, and when we talk about settlements, we aren't talking about, like, you know, a few little huts in the wilderness surrounded by a fence of sticks. What we're talking about are things that look like Southern California suburbs, you know, huge gated communities that are surrounded by barbed wire and surrounded by military force in order to keep them safe, and connected by a whole network of roads, many of which Palestinians are not allowed to drive on, sometimes not even allowed to cross, so that essentially what it does is it carves up that Palestinian territory into something more like that you see there. And makes it a lot harder to make a case for all these little squiggles that aren't even connected somehow being able to function as a state. And within the Oslo Accords, there are different areas that were, Area A was the heavy population, the towns, the cities. Area B was sort of the second level of population, villages and smaller towns. And Area C was the countryside. And there were restrictions. Israelis are not allowed to enter Area A by law. Palestinians are not allowed to enter Israel proper unless they have a permit, which is really difficult to get. So up until 91, there's a lot of free movement between the West Bank and Israel proper. A lot of Palestinians worked in Israel. They often worked all the low-level jobs that nobody else wanted to do, but they had work, and they did that work, and they had an economy based on that. Israelis would go into the West Bank. You know, some of the villages along the border were places people would come and shop on the weekends, and there's actually good relations between many Palestinians and many Israelis. In 91, after the first Gulf War, they instituted this permit system, and in 93, after the Oslo Accords, they made it stricter and more permanent. Then in 2003 and 4, after the second intifada was going, the Israelis decided to build a wall. The Israelis like to call it the separation wall. Everyone else calls it the apartheid wall. The idea was, we'll stop all these suicide bombs. You know, we'll just build a wall between these two states. Thing was, this wall didn't follow the green line, the 67th border. This wall, this is the root of the wall. It snaked in deep into Palestinian territory. Because in places like here, you have huge settlements. It's a settlement called Ariel that's got 50,000 people living in it. You know, you've got all this territory that had been taken into these settlements, which are illegal because, again, by international law, you're not allowed to take a conquered people and plant your own people there. And solidifies that. So you might ask, why? Why does Israel want this land so much? Why do they want the West Bank in particular so intensely that they're actually willing to risk their security, their international standing, they're willing to spend? I mean, the cost of this wall, which is about 700 kilometers long, is like 2 million euros per kilometer. You know, a staggering amount of money. Well, here's one reason. This is a map of ancient Israel. The settlements, the places the Bible talks about, and a whole lot of them were not along the coast, because that was where the Philistines lived. They were up in the hills, and they were up in the mountains, and they were in the area that now is the West Bank. So that is really, in some ways, the historical heartland. But here's the other reason. This is where the water is, the underground aquifers, which actually makes sense that the ancient settlements were where the water is. There's the coastal aquifer here, and there is the mountain aquifers here, and those are the major sources of water that underlie that land. Israel is a Mediterranean climate, kind of like San Francisco. In fact, many places in the hills actually have a similar rainfall to San Francisco, 25 inches so a year. It's not all desert, though it does have a lot of desert. But there's a lot of water under the ground. There's big, important aquifers which make it possible to do agriculture through irrigation. So if we're looking at the ecofeminist analysis, the eco part of it is just like they always said in the Watergate trials, follow the money, follow the water. Here's sort of a diagram of land. You know, there's this ridge of mountains that runs through the center, and the water collects in these aquifers, which are primarily in Palestinian West Bank. And of that water, the average daily water consumption, it's a graph kind of like this. The Israelis use a hugely amount more water. If you look at the settlements, you know, they are have lush lawns and huge plantings and swimming pools and bathtubs and stuff. And the Palestinian villages are often on a very small ration of water. Some of them actually, especially in these last couple of years of drought, have had their water completely dry up and complete drought. So the daily consumption, there's something like 5% of the population in the West Bank are settlers, and they use 80% of the water. Again, see where the aquifers are, and this is the route again, thinking of that route of the wall. These are the drilling and pumping conditions, and you can see how the wall kind of confiscates a lot of the good drilling and the water sources that are there in the West Bank. One of the other issues under contention is always Jerusalem, because it is the holy city for Jews, for Christians, for Muslims. And the Dome of the Rock, El-Aqsa, the Muslim, like, capital, kind of heartland, central shrine, happens to be like literally on top of the Wailing Wall, the remains of the old Jewish temple. So it's kind of like very hard to separate out these two. And nobody wants to let go of Jerusalem. But historically, there were Israelis living in West Jerusalem and a lot of Palestinians and Arabs living in East Jerusalem. And again, part of this building of settlements has been to constantly plant new communities and new housing units in East Jerusalem, then surround them by these walls and these checkpoints and make it harder and harder for Palestinians and Arabs to continue to live in East Jerusalem, and sort of like, you know, like nibbling and nibbling and nibbling away until you have what they like to call facts on the ground. You know, you have all these settlements, you have all these walls, and that makes it a lot harder in negotiations to take them down, even though they're there illegally. So here's what it looked like when I went there first in 2002. My friend Netta took me into Bethlehem. It was a eerie experience to go into a city completely closed, completely shut down. Nobody's out on the streets. Nothing is happening there. Everybody's hidden in their houses. It was like something out of a science fiction novel. But we were in Jerusalem doing some trainings together when we got a call that the Israelis were raiding Balata, the refugee camp next to Nablus. And we all went out in a van. And at that time, before they built the wall, there were checkpoints that you had to go through to get from Israel proper into Palestine, to get from Palestine to Israel. But there were a lot of ways around the checkpoints. So you could get driven around, you could walk around them, you could hike through the mountains around them. And we got driven to a place where we could hike in, avoid the checkpoints, and hike down into, again, this eerily empty city where nobody was out on the streets, where it seemed like there was absolutely no life at all. But as we started to walk down those streets, people would come out of their houses, people would wave at us, people would come out and offer us like seeds or water. And for me, you know, that was a moment when I realized that even though I had sort of overcome my upbringing enough to go there, right, there was a deep part of me that still was conditioned by this idea that somehow Palestinians were the enemy and they were going to hate me. And they were dangerous and they were, you know, people I should be afraid of. And I hadn't realized how deep that went until that night we found ourselves on the street in the middle of Balata just as it was getting dark. It was very dangerous to be there after dark because the soldiers would shoot at anyone and they couldn't see whether you were an international, if they cared about that or not. And we were standing there. We were on the other side of the refugee camp from our contact. We called her, and she just said, "Go into any house. They'll take you in." And we kind of looked at each other, and suddenly from a balcony, somebody waved at us, and within like 5 minutes, we were all taken into people's homes. And it was just a profound, you know, I had taught ritual, I taught spirituality, I've led people on a million trances to go in and face your most deepest fear. But I hadn't realized until that moment how much my deepest fear had to do with these people I'd been trained to think of were the other. Mm. And being taken in like that was a profound spiritual shift for me. And that time, all the men in the refugee camp had been rounded up, so no one was there but women. And a few, you know, people like, you know, there was one young man whose family had hit him because he was had suffered a brain injury and wasn't, you know, had developmental damage. And they were trying, he hoped to have international stay there to intervene if the soldiers came in. There were women, there were children, and suddenly we were in the middle of people's homes who were so warm and so welcoming. You know, the whole Palestinian culture still has those ancient Middle Eastern traditions of welcome. and took us in, and it was, for me, like an amazing shift to feel that people were so willing to offer us trust and to let us into their homes and let us into their lives. So I spent time there in Bamata, and then later that summer we went to Jenin. Jenin was under tight curfew for months, and this is kind of what it looked like. And what would happen is they'd lift the curfew for a few hours so people could go to market and maybe try to go to their jobs or buy some food, and then suddenly the tanks would roll in again. And people would run back to their houses. But what the ISM was doing there was a lot of kind of wild young people in that particular crew who would go out and stand in front of the tanks and kind of say, hey, there's internationals here, there's a witness here, and try to prevent them from actually shooting up the marketplace. So we were sort of sent there. Our little affinity group was a bunch of older women and one young guy. The idea that we'd be a kind of like a sobering influence on them, but somehow within about 5 minutes we were out in the middle of the street waiting for the tanks, kind of looking at each other. I remember having this immense feeling of like, this is where my mother never wanted me to be. How did I get here? So the other thing that always amazed me, though, was again the resilience of the people. Like, the tanks would, you know, people would get word the tanks were rolling in, the market would pack up, people would be all back side street, people would be in each other's houses, or they'd bring a couple chairs out to the front, sit there and wait and sort of have a little family party while the tanks rolled up and down the streets and the young kids ran out to throw stones at them. And then as soon as the tanks went away, out would come the coffee pot and the market, and everybody would be kind of back to normal again. I remember one of the young guys on the street kind of looking at me, and we were talking. He was, you know, he was an art student in the college. And, you know, you see those news things of, you know, angry young men throwing rocks, kind of. You're like, who are those angry young men? He was like someone who could have gone to CIIS if he were here. You know, he wanted to travel. He wanted to see the world. He was like any 18-year-old. But, you know, when he said it, it's like, we know it doesn't do any good to throw rocks. Rocks against tanks. It's ridiculous. But we have to do something. We just can't let them come in here and not do something. So, these are some images of the refugee camps after the bulldozers had come through. And I've tried to mostly focus in these pictures on things, places I was and things I've seen, but you could substitute Gaza, you could substitute any of these places that have been so shelled and bombed and destroyed. It's just a tremendous pile of rubble and destruction. And yet people attempting to stay there and live their lives in the midst of it. One of our ISM guys. Densely packed pieces of ground on the planet. So in Rafah, you had this sort of feeling that you had like this underlying reality that went back to almost to ancient times, where people were still living in their houses, and you know, we stayed with people who were had their chickens in the backyard and were so proud of serving us their own eggs and giving us oranges to take with us from their own trees. And then you had these big apartment blocks that were the refugees who had we're now refugees from decades, but we're this overlay on this even older culture. And in 2003 and 2004, the Israelis started to build the apartheid wall. So there began to be, in the villages in the West Bank, organizing against the wall. And I went to a peace camp at a place called Masa at the end of that trip, where some of the first, where people had decided, what can we do? The wall is coming through, and the wall was confiscating huge amounts of their farmland, their trees, the land they depended on to make a living. So they decided to have a peace camp in the path of the wall and to invite Israelis to actually come and join them and start to build a movement that was a joint movement of Palestinians and Israelis. So here are some of the demonstrations. See, there were women out there in the olive grove sitting in front of the bulldozers, cranes. That's what the wall looked like when it was being built. See, the, it wasn't just like a wall, it was like a swath of destruction over the whole countryside. And actually, and there's a settlement kind of behind it there.
That's an Israeli settlement?
Yeah, Israeli settlement. I always like to show this picture because they've got solar hot water. And you can kind of see the path of the wall behind there. And there were people still trying, like this woman, this ancient woman who was out there, part of the demonstration. And young people, teenagers, girls from school. Women going and sitting in front of the bulldozers. Tear gas out in the olive fields. And these are some of the olive trees that had been heavily, heavily pruned before being dug up and moved, because olive trees are pretty tough and you can actually prune them way back and move them. So sometimes the Palestinians would try to move them out of the path and save them, but often the Israelis would actually move them and replant them in the settlements. And the nonviolent resistance had some successes. There were a couple of places, like Bilin, where they got the root of the wall moved so that it didn't confiscate so much farmland. This doesn't seem like a huge success in the vast scale of things, but in the context of Palestine, even the smallest amount of success was so amazing to people that it inspired more and more and more organizing and more action. But the wall did get built, and there continues to be resistance and all kinds, especially among the art as resistance. One of the other issues with the settlements is that often when they built the settlements, they didn't bother to build sewage treatment. Or if they do build sewage treatment, there are times when they have a flood or it overflows, and so they just dump raw sewage onto Palestinian fields. And so this is like a puddle of it out in the back of one of the settlements that I was taken to see. The settlements also harass the Palestinians. One of the things the ISM would do in the villages was go with people to the harvest or go with them to their fields, again, to be a witness and a buffer, to prevent them from being harassed and shot at while they were trying to harvest or while they were trying to plow. And, you know, it was also hopeful to see people really, again, I remember going to the peace camp at Masa, and there was a young man who was doing calligraphy on a stone in Arabic, and he read it out to me and explained what it said was, "The earth speaks Arabic." Palestinians have a deep connection to the land, and they really love the land, and they maintain so many of the old traditions, including the olive harvest, where families come out to their trees and harvest together every year. And they are constantly looking for new ways to continue to make a living in spite of the Israeli occupation. So somebody had set up a project of beekeeping, and we were starting a beekeeping project in one of the villages. And this is one of the women from Fatah who invited me to come and do some of the trainings with women there. And this young woman is an Israeli who was a part of this movement, you know, to join with the Palestinians and protest the building of the wall. And there are Israelis, you know, not huge numbers of them, but there are some really amazingly courageous Israelis who have crossed that line and continue to come over and stand with Palestinians and face again, the violence of the army and the tear gas and, you know, the real threat of intense physical harm in order to, again, you know, one of them said to me, you know, it's not that we're Israelis or Palestinians, we are people standing together for justice. So she was... And there were some very strong and beautiful friendships that developed. And some really nice moments. Like, remember the peace camp at Masa, seeing one of the young Palestinian guys sitting there, like, poring over this book that was something like human sexual variety, right? With great interest. There were some other very funny moments, like, there was a group of gay and lesbian Israelis called Kvisa Shpora, which means black laundry or dirty laundry, and meeting with the village elders and the Israeli lesbians. And we went around and introduced and explained what our groups were, and the young guy who was translating for the elders, when they said, "We're a gay and lesbian group," I just saw his face kind of go. I said to him afterwards, "Now, how did you translate that?" Right? He said, "Carefully." But, you know, there were some really kind of wonderful moments of that kind of exchange. And I think, you know, one of the things that supports this idea of occupation is this idea that somehow Israelis and Palestinians can't get along. You know, that this is a human, you know, that they hate each other, that they can't get along with each other. The reality is, what I've seen is, as soon as you move out of the context of maintaining the occupation, people actually get along extremely well, because these cultures are far more similar than they are different in so many ways. And I think that there's actually a hidden hunger for people to connect and to learn from each other and to connect with each other. I mean, the cultures are like cousins, really. And there's so many similar aspects. You know, the Jewish culture, I was always taught, you know, we believe in education, you know. Palestinians have the highest number of PhDs per capita of any people in the world. They strongly believe in education. You know, I grew up with a Jewish grandmother who could stuff you easily through more food than you ever wanted to eat, but she would really, you know, have some strong competition from the Palestinian women I met, who really, I finally had to like beg one of them to tell me, like, how do I, you know, how do I get them to stop feeding me? I don't want to be rude, but how do I make this stop? I said, "You have to go like this. Halas." So Gaza, yeah, now I was there right after Rachel was Corey was killed because I went down to support the team that was with her, and went back just a couple of weeks later when another ISM volunteer was shot. At that time, it was hard to do traditional nonviolent intervention because the Israeli soldiers, you never saw them face to face. They were up in these big sniper towers where they would shoot into the towns and shoot up some of the villages, or they were prowling around in tanks. And there were these gigantic bulldozers clearing this swath along the border because they wanted to have this huge empty zone along the border between Egypt and Israel to prevent people from smuggling anything or smuggling people across. Now, my friend Ahmed Salah, who's sitting there back, who's Egyptian, who was one of the leaders actually of the Arab Spring in Egypt, he tells me that al-Sisi, the president of Egypt, has made a deal, and just in the last few months, the Egyptians have now begun doing the same thing, clearing a swath on the other side of the border, on the Egyptian side, blowing up homes, confiscating them, picking people out, because they need Israel's support to keep them in power and keep them in the good graces of the U.S. government, because they are basically an illegitimate military dictatorship that's taken over and has really, you know, is really horrific to the forces in Egypt that are struggling for democracy. So they've been offering people, you know, it's compensation for your home. They are giving people $50 a month for 3 months. Mm-hmm. That's it. Goodbye. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, the Israelis don't offer any compensation at all. And if they did, the Palestinians won't take it. So this was Gaza kind of in the good times. And these are like these mammoth house-sized bulldozers that come through and just completely destroy everything in their path. But this is, you know, the ISM, when we were there, we were doing a couple different things. I was doing support for the teams that is not, you know, how about like terrified? But Abu Ahmed was one of the houses we stayed at. He was kind of the patriarch of the family, and they had lived in this house again for generations and generations. And every night he'd make tea and sit there, and friends would come over, and they'd brew a kettle on his little fireplace and sit and talk. And there was an aspect of it where, in spite of all of this madness, you kind of felt like you were back in Bible times with just sitting around the campfire, telling stories at night, hearing the local gossip, living the culture that people were still trying to preserve. And that was Rachel, who was standing in front of a bulldozer to prevent it from demolishing a house, and the bulldozer ran over her. And then Tom, a couple of weeks later, there were a group of children who were being fired on from a sniper tower. Often they'd fire at kids, usually above their heads, but, you know, it was terrifying to the children and extremely dangerous. And Tom ran in, grabbed a couple kids and brought them out, and then ran in back again, and the sniper actually targeted him and shot him in the head. He was in a coma for 9 months and then finally died. So there's their Shahid posters, the posters for martyrs that are always put up around. So, you know, again, those were the relatively good times in Gaza. In 2005, Israel pulled out of Gaza. There were some small Israeli settlements there that made life hell for the Gazans because the Israelis maintained checkpoints and oftentimes couldn't go from one side of Gaza to the other without, you know, the checkpoint might be closed for 3 days when you're trying to get back to school or if you had to go to the hospital. But in 2005, Netanyahu decided unilaterally, we're just going to pull out of Gaza. Sounds good, right? But what that meant was they basically pulled out of any responsibility for maintaining health and life and support services in Gaza and maintained control from outside. And it became very, very difficult for outsiders to get in and out of Gaza. They inflamed some of the differences between the Palestinian factions, Hamas and Fatah, and started what was almost a civil war within Gaza. But eventually Hamas, which is the more militant and more Islamist faction, took over in Gaza. In the West Bank, Fatah, which was originally came from the PLO, the People's Liberation Organization, which was kind of a commie lefty 1970s, you know, Yasser Arafat group. They're the more secular, and they're the ones who were more willing to make peace with Israel. But they also have this tremendous reputation for corruption. And a lot of people are very angry with them for their collaboration with the Israeli authorities. They took over the West Bank. And, you know, Israel has been very good at playing off these tensions within Palestinian society. Because it's really to Israel's advantage to keep them separated. In 2008, you know, when Obama had been elected but hadn't yet taken office, the Israelis mounted this huge assault on Gaza and killed 1,400 people, destroyed something like hundreds and hundreds of homes and public buildings, and since that time, were very, very reluctant to allow any building material, any concrete, any cement, anything people needed to rebuild back into Gaza. Gaza is kind of like they call it the world's largest open-air prison. And then, of course, this summer, Israel mounted another assault on Gaza, killed something like 2,200 people, vast majority of whom were civilians, hundreds of whom were children. Bombed again, public buildings, universities, UN centers, which were supposed to be safe places, hospitals, and again, make it tremendously difficult to do any rebuilding. So I want to switch and talk a little bit about some of the hopeful aspects, which might seem hard to get to, but to say, I couldn't get in for many years, because I had tried to get back in 2007 and basically got deported from the airport, denied entry. But in 2011, there was an international permaculture convergence in Jordan that focused on dry lands. And I went to the convergence, and since I was there and I was that close, having many friends, decided I would try to get back in. It's hard to, you know, it's hard to like go buy a $1,200 ticket and fly somewhere if you're not sure you're going to be able to get in there or not. But since I was there, I could try to go in overland. And there was a tour from after the convergence that went to see sites in Palestine, permaculture sites. And I did actually succeed in getting back in with the tour. I managed to convince them that I had seen the error of my ways and was no longer interested in interfering with tanks and military personnel, but just wanted to feed. So, some of the hopeful things that I see happening in Palestine are, you know, the many ways that people are working in spite of all of these constraints and horrific conditions and stuff, to actually take that Palestinian love for the land and develop permaculture sites, nature sites, to really look and say, how do we build long-term sustainability and survivability into this land? Because, again, I see that as a key part of resistance, is staying there. To be able to stay there, you need the resources. So we went to one place, Bustan Karaka, which is near Bethlehem, in a town called Beit Sahur, where they had built the most astounding bottle wall of natural building I'd ever seen.
Wow.
And there were a couple of botanists who had started this who were English, but they were working with the local community. They'd taken this olive orchard, which had basically wasn't producing, dug swales, did water catchment, water harvesting, and brought it back into production. They were planting all kinds of different things, from mesquite to hundreds of different local varieties of desert plants and drought-resistant plants, to do trials and to find out what worked and what was going to help regenerate the land. They had dug huge water storage, which captured rainwater in the winter, and all of their plants and gardens ran off of this during the summer. And had done some really important and really visionary kind of work. They also had a sister project that was starting an aquaponics program in the local village. Aquaponics is a way of growing fish and plants together so that the fish waste fertilize the plants and the plants clean the water. So you can produce a lot of food in a very small space, and it uses something like 70 to 90% less water than conventional farming. So it can be a key resource, especially in the West Bank, where people now don't have much access to the coast or to fish or to seafood or things that are traditionally part of their diet. That's what it's about. And then there is a farm in a village called Marda, where we visited in 2011, and where last year I was able to get back and teach a permaculture course. It was started by Moran Al-Khufash, who is a local boy from the village. His family has lived there from generations and generations, and in fact there's a castle in the village, goes back to Ottoman times, that is his family castle. And he started this farm as a permaculture demonstration. That was my co-teacher Jillian, and in this area of these ancient olive trees, and hundreds of years old. Really incredible, amazing. A very beautiful area, up on the hills, beautiful views over the valley and the other villages. But it is just underneath Ariel, the largest of the Israeli settlements. So right up on top of the hill is this, where he used to play, up there where he used to play soccer as a kid and watch the goats, is now this like gigantic gated community that the Palestinians are not allowed to enter and go into, have any contact with. And again, Ariel, often when its sewage treatment gets overloaded or overflows, gets dumped on Palestinian land. When tensions get tough, settlers in the army can stand up above and shoot down into the village below. Even though Marda is a relatively peaceful and well-off place by Palestinian standards, there's still this constant thing of looking up, and there are the conquerors right above your head. Ancient well in the mountains. And this is some of his permaculture design. He's growing beautiful, lush plants and garden, again, on very little water, very rough soil. His greenhouse. Thank you. which mimic a natural forest, but where every element in it is something that either is useful for humans or helps support and sustain the system. One of our students meditating in the olive tree. This was the castle. And one of our students, Sahar, works for an organization called ReWalk, which is attempting to preserve the architectural heritage of Palestine. And they go into the villages and restore some of the old buildings and get some international aid to do that. Because part of the long term, you know, part of it is, again, part of the resistance is preserving the culture, preserving the heritage. Again, establishing, like, we're here, we've always been here. This wasn't empty land, this wasn't a blank space on the map. This was a culture, this was a heritage that goes back hundreds and thousands of years, and we need to respect it and preserve it. So this was Murad's family castle that...